talking about the ways we feel stuck in a rut in our lives, or stuck in a moment. The times we feel stuck in a moment, as the song put it. And we can't get out of it. And as the song suggests, right, you've got to stand up straight, carry your own weight. You've got to get yourself together. And if you've ever been stuck before, you know that that can be hard to do sometimes. You know, in the moment, yeah, I know I've got to get myself together. I know I've got to get my stuff together. I know what I need to do. But it's easier said than done, isn't it? Just build better habits. Easier said than done. Change your perspective. Easier said than done. Remember all the good. Step out of your comfort zone. And as we learned last week, clean up the pile of clothes in your room. Step out of your comfort zone. Easier said than done. Although I have to thank some people who sent me pictures of the piles and then the cleaned up piles. That was encouraging to me. Thank you for that. There are things, these are all things that we invited you to practice throughout this week. And we hope that you do. Throughout this series, we hope that you've practiced some of these things, put some of these things into practice. We hope that they're helpful. We believe that they're helpful. We believe that these are tools and techniques that help us get unstuck. But still, the fact of the matter is that they are all easier said than done. Because when we're stuck in a rut, we want out. We want out. No one wants to be stuck in a rut. And I think that's a natural response. Because being stuck just isn't fun. It's not enjoyable. It's difficult. It's challenging. It takes its toll on us. But what if stuck is exactly where you need to be? Even though it's not enjoyable, even though it's hard, even though it's messy, even though it's challenging, even though you're wearing thin, what if your rut is also your place of renewal? What if your rut is the exact place God wants to meet you, to grow you? Proverbs 14:4 says this. As I was thinking about this topic this week and I stumbled across this proverb, I was like, this is spot on. Where there are no oxen, it says, the manger is empty. The trough is clean. It's empty, it's clean, and that sounds nice. That sounds nice. No mess, no nasty work, right? Don't have to take care of these oxen, which I imagine is pretty difficult work. But from the strength of an ox come abundant harvests. From the mess comes the harvest. So what if the muddy rut we find ourselves stuck in is also the rich soil that God is trying to plant us in? Perhaps the rut that we're in, the rut that we're so desperately trying to escape, the rut that we just want to get out of, is itself the very means by which we get unstuck. And you're like, wait, hold on a second. Did that make sense? It's sort of like, again, a lot of random things popped into my head as I was preparing for this talk this morning. It's sort of like this scene in Harry Potter. There's this, I know, like, whoa, Austin, Harry Potter, you're going to go there? Whether you like it, read it, watch it, or not, I did because my parents didn't have an issue with it growing up. I also collected Pokemon cards growing up, if we're airing it all out there, okay? Like, you know what? And I'm I'm still a pastor. Wow, they take anyone these days, I guess. Anyway, there's a plant in Harry Potter, and it's called the Devil's Snare. I know, of course it's called that, Austin. Harry Potter is the Devil's Snare. Okay, so anyway, there's a clip that I want to show you guys. It'll help me kind of paint the picture for us. So if you guys would, check this out.
Whoa. Luckiest plant thing's here, really. Whoa! Stop moving, both of you. This is Devil's Snare. You have to relax. If you don't, it'll only kill you faster.
Kill us faster? Oh, now I can relax.
Hermione!
Now what are we gonna do?
Just relax.
Hermione, where are you?
Do what I say. Trust me.
Please don't send me any emails about whether a Christian should or shouldn't watch Harry Potter. That's what I'm looking for. So, Devil's Snare. If you come in contact with it, it wraps its vines around you, and it binds you. And the more you struggle, the more you fight against it, the stronger its grip on you gets. However, if you can relax or be still, so to speak, it'll let you go. Sometimes we get caught up in the struggle, caught up in the fight to get out of our rut, to just pull ourselves together, to carry our own weight. And what happens is we just end up more stuck. We've created an even bigger rut. Sometimes we just need to be still and trust that this season will end and a new one will come. And again, easier said than done, right? Some seasons, some ruts we find ourselves in just feel like they're going to last forever, like winter in northern Indiana. But the reality is that there is an end to every season. We find this in the scriptures. In Ecclesiastes 3, says this: there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the sun, under the heavens. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. COVID. A time to search. I'm just kidding. Oh, man. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. A time and a season for everything. Just as the winter has its time, so does spring. Our ruts can bring renewal. Throughout the scriptures, God's people experience the full spectrum of times and seasons. Especially rut seasons. God's people since the fall, which we could probably consider the very first rut experience, they have known what it's like to feel stuck, to feel down and out. And yet time and time again, we see God making a way for his people, moving towards his people. For Noah, it was an ark and a promise. For Job, a man who experienced a rut his entire life, God knelt and responded to his resolute faith. For Abraham and Sarah, it was a son born to them in their old age after waiting for 25 long years. In Egypt, God's people were stuck in slavery until God raised up Moses and delivered them by splitting a sea in half. While Israel was stuck wandering the desert for 40 more years, God led them. He provided for them, and he dwelt among them. When Israel was stuck outside of Jericho, God brought those walls down. When Israel was stuck without a righteous king, God raised up David. When Israel was stuck without God's word, God brought them prophets. When Jonah was stuck in the belly of a fish, God brought him to dry land. When Israel was stuck in Babylon, God raised up leaders. When Rome rose to power and God's people were stuck under its boot, God sent a child. Time and time again, and countless others. I can't list them all. Countless other times in the scriptures, God has shown up in the midst of ruts, in the midst of the moments when God's people are stuck, and makes a way. I'm not saying that when we find ourselves in a rut that we should just roll over and do nothing. That's not the point. We spent 4 weeks talking about things we can do to honor God with our lives when we find ourselves in ruts. And I said last week the worst thing you can do in a rut is sit on your butt. And I still think that's true. But perhaps even worse than that is to forget who has your back in the rut. Who is with you? The truth is, amidst the struggle, if we could just remember to take a second to be still and know that God is God and that he is in control and that he loves you, he cares for you. He wants what's best for you. Despite what it might look like in your life right now, he wants what's best for you. Perhaps where you are, whatever rut you find yourself in, is exactly where God is going to do something in your life. Is exactly where God is going to grow you. Transform you. Perhaps the rut that you find yourself in is where God has planted you. God, through the prophet Isaiah, reminds Israel of this, and I believe us too. He says in Isaiah 43, verses 18 through 19, "Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland." These words remind us that no matter how stuck in a rut we feel, how stuck we feel in our current situation, whether it's in our job, it's unfulfilling, we're not motivated by it, where is our purpose in it, whether it's in our marriage, it's gone stale. It feels like we're falling out of love. Whether it's as we parent our kids, we just can't figure out what has gone wrong. We can't figure out what we did and how to fix it, how to change it, these ruts that we find ourselves in. God is wanting to bring new life. He is bringing and working forth new life in your ruts. God is doing a new thing. He is making a way in the wilderness, because those ruts can feel like a wilderness. They can feel like a desert. When the scriptures say streams in the wasteland, streams in the desert, God is doing a new thing. He makes dry land through seas, for goodness sakes. He makes the barren bear fruit. And he makes our ruts soil for seeds of growth. This week I was having a conversation with someone about this series. And he was telling me just about all the ruts that he's experienced in his life and lately. One that happened recently. And essentially the gist of our conversation was that even though these ruts that we go through, even though they're uncomfortable, even though they're challenging, even though they're difficult, even though they cause us to step out of our comfort zone, to trust that God's got this. Even though it's challenging and uncomfortable for us to go to those places, every rut has been an opportunity to grow, he said. Every rut he's gone through has been a learning experience. He's learned lessons. And in some of the ruts, he's learned lessons from some of these ruts that have helped him get out of others and will now help prevent more in the future. The Apostle Paul writes in Romans 8:28, he says, "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose." Through our ruts, God is working good in us. Through our ruts, God is making a way. Through our ruts, we can experience renewal. God is doing a new thing. I believe that our ruts are just rich soil for us to be planted in, for a seed to be planted. And Jesus kind of uses this same analogy. And this is in John 12:23. Jesus says, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." And again, this was his way of saying the time has come for his trial. The time has come for him to carry the cross that he would hang and die on for the sins of the world, so that we may be made right with God, so that we might have access to the Father and his resurrection power. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead 3 days later is the same power that grows within us when we place our faith and trust in Jesus. The same power that resurrected Jesus is the same spirit that resurrects us. It's the same spirit that brings renewal and growth into our lives, into our ruts, in the midst of our ruts. Verse 24, "Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls into the ground," some of your translations say, "a seed falls into the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds because it grows. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, and anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life." The same way a seed grows in the dirt, we grow in our ruts. The same way a seed grows in the dirt, we grow in our ruts. And I think that's a challenging thought for us to have, because I think this entire series has really been about the ways that we can get out of our ruts. And I think that's a good thing, because we don't want to stay in ruts for too long. But the truth is, sometimes ruts come on our lives because we've been complacent. And what they are is it's an opportunity for us to grow. It's a season where God can use to kind of shake us awake. Hey, what's going on in your marriage? Isn't working. And this isn't a sign that it's over. This isn't a sign that you've fallen out of love. You don't just fall out of love. Love is a choice. In your job, it's a sign that you have put your purpose, you have put your worth in something that will fade. Your identity isn't what you do. It is who God made you. That's in his image. To do good work in the world. To reflect his image out into the world. In our relationships. Sometimes these ruts come upon us because they are an opportunity for us to grow. And it's God saying, trust me. Trust me. And sometimes it is like the devil's snare. We just need to relax. Breathe. God, I trust you. And sometimes it's a toe out of that rut. And other times you emerge like a seed. And that's what's interesting about a seed. Is the seed doesn't escape the dirt. There's no escaping the dirt for a seed. I imagine if a seed could talk, it would no doubt complain about being put in the cold, dark rut of the earth. The seed is helpless. It is helpless until it dies. And when it does, it grows. And it doesn't escape the dirt. It emerges from the dirt stronger. It grows. Jesus goes on, anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. By hating our life, He's comparing our trust with God, comparing a life that honors God with our own desires, our own comforts. Our own desire for control, for pleasure, for power, for money, safety. And how those things should pale in comparison to the way that we live our lives to honor Christ. It should almost seem like we hate those things or we despise those things about our life, because they just pale in comparison to how we follow Jesus. By laying aside our striving and struggling, by trusting that when we are still and when we know that God is God, by releasing control in our lives and transferring control to Jesus, he will lead us to life and life abundant. He will lead us to a life of joy and peace, to a life that bears fruit in this world. Even amidst the ruts, there can be growth. And so again, I hope that there's been something in this series, week by week, step by step, that you have grabbed onto, that you've taken with you, whether it's to put it in a toolbox, to have for later, for when the seasons change and the ruts enter into your life, or you find yourself in one right now. And while these tools are helpful, they can be overwhelming. And so I hope today, if these tools are just overwhelming to you, that I can just remind you that God is with you. He is with you. And he is making a way. I promise. Trust him. Trust him. And so maybe this week, this idea of embracing the rut, reflecting on the life experience that we are in, might be the step for you. As we relax, because we find ourselves in the devil's snare, can we be still and know who defeated the devil and who gives us the power to grow, to be renewed in our ruts? Through our ruts, we can experience renewal and new life in the name and power of Jesus. Can I pray? Jesus, I'm just so grateful again for this opportunity to be here this morning, to be together. God together in this space. There are lots of us come from different places, different experiences, different ruts. God, I speak your name in this place and over these ruts, over the anxiety that we might feel, the stress that we might feel, amidst the fear that we might be experiencing, because we don't know what the other side looks like. God, we don't even know what the next step looks like. And so, Jesus, we pray your name. Jesus, that your name it is good. And Jesus, you have many names, and one of those names is Emmanuel, and that is God with us. God, you're in us. You're with us in the highs, when we're on the mountaintops, when life is good, when following you it seems easy. Jesus, would you remind us amidst the ruts in our lives that you are nearer still? God, would you speak to us? As we just are in your presence in this moment, would you speak to us? God, you are good, and it is good to be your people, and it is good to be here today. And we know at the end of the day, our ruts will produce growth. If we can place our faith and trust in you, Jesus, our ruts can bring renewal. So we pray for renewal. We pray for renewal in our community, in this church, in the way that we get the opportunity to impact this community. I pray for renewal in those who are here this morning who are struggling at work. God, would you give them purpose in who you are and who you made them to be? God, I pray for renewal in our relationships, as siblings, as friends, as spouses. I pray for your forgiveness and your grace and your mercy. God, as we parent, would you lead us and guide us? I pray for renewal in those relationships. God, as we struggle to step out of our comfort zones, I pray for renewal in our lives, for faith in the fear. And God, I pray for renewed minds and renewed hearts, soft hearts, when we find ourselves in the ruts, to be led by you, to take steps towards you, towards Christ, as we adjust course. Jesus, we love you and we praise you, and we're gonna sing about your love, and it is gonna be so good. So God, we lift you up and we praise your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.